There goes Davis.
Oh, my gosh.
Davis is going to run it all the way
here
back.
Here comes pressure. Bortles sees it coming. Looking for Wharton in the end zone. Wharton behind the defense. Oh! Are you kidding?
He had 14 spring practice sessions, and just one remains, and it'll be under the bright lights of Bobby Dodd Stadium. Georgia Tech's final spring practice, guided by head coach Paul Johnson, starts right now on ESPN3. Unfortunately, it is gray and very soggy, but we have the gold white game nonetheless. A spring game at Georgia Tech here in the flats in Midtown Atlanta. And we welcome you, everybody, up here in the booth alongside Roddy Jones. I'm Brandon Gauden. Thanks for tuning in. Roddy, Mother Nature did not do the Jackets any favor here this evening.
It certainly didn't. This is not the weather that you'd like for a spring game on either side of the gold or the white team. A little bit cooler, a little bit rainier than they would have liked, but hey, it's football nonetheless.
It is football nonetheless. I know there's a lot of things that fans and you and I want to see from this game, in particular with Vadley now gone at the quarterback position. Justin Thomas, Tim Byerly, we'll see who impresses.
They definitely will, and it's really about moving the offense, taking care of the football, especially on a day like today. Which quarterback's going to provide the consistency to consistently have their offense score? That's really what the name of the game is about for any offense, but in the triple option offense as well.
Yeah, so we'll see which quarterback shines, but there's a lot more storylines than that, and we'll get to them all with the kick after this right here on ESPN3. Welcome back live to Bobby Dodd Stadium, everybody. Mother Nature is not our friend tonight, but nonetheless, we are here. If you haven't made it out to the flats with Roddy Jones, I'm Brandon Gauden in the booth, and we are just moments away from starting this spring game between the gold and the white team. Now, a couple of notes about this, Roddy. First off, and folks that watch spring games around the nation know this, but there will not be any kickoffs. There won't be any rushing the punter when they do the punt sessions. Both teams will start on the 30. So a little unorthodox. What else can we expect to see? Just rules-wise, it's different from a normal game.
Like you said, there's no kickoffs. There's no rushing of the kicks. The way it's set up is you've got the number one offense and the number two defense on one team, the number two offense and the number one defense on the other team. So you'll have ones versus ones and twos versus twos as you go during the course of the game. But other than that, it's pretty much real football. You know, you're going to see blocking, tackling, and hopefully a lot of great ball today.
And so, like Roddy said, the gold team, you're seeing there Isaiah Johnson, who's back from injury, but the gold team is the second team offense and first team defense. So you're seeing the first team defense out there on the gold side, the white team showing the first team offense, and then later you'll see the second team defense for them. And we are going to get it started in just a moment, as I said, on the 30-yard line. And it won't be Justin Thomas under center first, but Roddy, it will be Tim Byerly. And as you said in the open, this is certainly something that fans want to see. Who shows, and again, it's just spring, but who shows well today? Will it be Byerly or will it be Thomas? Will it hopefully be both?
And no matter what happens today, spring game is just kind of a summation of everything. These guys have already had 14 practices under their belt. Coaches have evaluated them through each one of these practices. So no matter what happens today, certainly they both want to go out and prepare well, but it's not the end-all, be-all their performance here today.
So there's Byerly, played last year sparingly as a second backup. First play from scrimmage, going to be a first down and also a flag as the pitch out to the right there to Tony Zinnen for over 10 yards. You see the rain has just picked up in the last 10 minutes, coming down a little more steadily.
It really has. And the biggest thing for both of these quarterbacks today is going to be center quarterback exchanges. And then that fullback quarterback exchange as well. A lot of times people are worried about the pitches, but the pitches are actually fairly easy to handle.
And the penalty there against the offense will back it up 10 yards. By the way, Sean Bedford, former Jacket as well, along with Roddy Jones to my right, former A-back. Sean Bedford is on the sidelines with us, and he'll be joining us intermittently throughout the broadcast as we get our first chance at Byerly throwing a pass right through the hands that time to B.J. Boston. And I think the weather showing early what it can do.
Certainly. While pitches are fairly easy to catch in the rain, the passes certainly are not. The ball is slick. It's a little bit cool out here also, so you don't have necessarily great feeling in all of your fingers. So B.J. Bostic not able to haul that one in.
And Bostic, we saw Tony Zinnen catch the pitch earlier. That A-back spot certainly is another one to track with the loss of Robbie Godhigh. Quayshawn Neely, boy, there's a guy at the linebacker position. You know, Paul Johnson is happy to have back. He is gonna be an anchor on the defense.
He really is. He's played a lot over the past couple of years. You see him blitzing in that backside B gap, crawling over an offensive lineman and getting into the legs of Tim Byerly. A great play by him. See, 3-year starter. He's just done a great job during the course of his career.
First series here with a first team offense in white and the first team defense for Georgia Tech in gold. It's a 3rd-and-11 situation here with Byerly under center. Going down the right side to nobody, incomplete.
Byerly's pass incomplete.
Looked like a little miscommunication there. Anytime you see a throw like that, it's typically a side adjustment. The quarterback sees one thing, receiver doesn't necessarily see the same thing and break off the route. It looked like Byerly expected Smelter to break back towards the sideline and threw it as such.
But even with the elements, Paul Johnson letting Byerly throw a couple passes there on the first series. And a first chance to see Ryan Rodwell. And again, no rushing of the punts. Rodwell taking over for the punting duties. Of course, for Sean Poole, and it's good to have Jamal Golden back, who injured his shoulder early on last year. But, you know, a lot of times you don't talk a lot about special teams and punters and kickers. Harrison Butker, certainly the surefire kicker this year, and Ryan Rodwell sat out last year because they knew that Sean Poole was going to be the punter. Now he has a couple years of eligibility left.
And things like that can flip the field for you, and they can really change games. I mean, you think about consistency and not allowing big returns. It really adds up over the course of a game.
So Ty Griffin will command the gold offense here as we get a look at the second offense in gold and the second defense in white.
And we've seen a lot of action so far from both sides, and it's kind of a testament to what they've been practicing on over the course of the spring. You've seen a lot of action off of this jet sweep, or a toss is what they call it here at Georgia Tech. We saw a couple of play action, one actual toss from the white side. Now from the gold side, we see the belly, the inside run there by the B-back.
Ty Griffin, the redshirt freshman, handing it off once again to Connors. So Connors gets two early touches at the B-back position. He's likely to back up both Zach Lasky, of course, and then also Travis Custis, who unfortunately Roddy cannot play in tonight's game. For those wondering why they haven't seen Custis already,
Travis Custis is a guy that has shown a lot this spring in his first spring here at Georgia Tech. Matt Connors, though, came on as a walk-on, earned his way, a hard runner out of Marist, has really, really made well for this offense.
First look at Broderick Snoddy, the fastest back, and then a nice play by Marvin defensively. He's fired up. John Marvin, the redshirt freshman from Fort Walton Beach, Florida, leveling Broderick Snotty here on the outside.
You saw the speed of Snotty able to get around the defender that penetrated into the backfield, but Marvin able to track him down, ran out of room, and Marvin certainly put a hit on him.
Second down and eight here as Ty Griffin goes back under center. And he loses the football. Down on the ground, and we have our first turnover.
And that's the biggest thing. And the ball wasn't even going to change hands there. Ty Griffin was trying to pull that ball and take it up the middle for himself. As you'll see here, tries to pull it, and he gets hit by Tremaine McNair right as he's pulling the ball out. But that's one of the biggest things. It's the quarterback center exchange, and it's those quarterback D-back exchanges that are the toughest in weather like this, especially with so many bodies around.
Patrick Gamble, the redshirt sophomore, played in eight games last year. Only had six tackles, though, used mainly as a backup. And getting the fumble recovery here and turning things back over the white squad. And then a flag comes in, and we're going to have a false start.
53 offense. It's a five-yard penalty.
We saw Quayshon Neely creeping up towards the line again on that play. Anytime you get that linebacker coming up, it starts to time the snap count. Makes your offensive lineman a little bit more nervous. They want to get a little bit of a head start because obviously the linebacker's got a running start and you don't. You want to get as much advantage as you can.
Roddy, should we, as first and 15, we're going to have another fumble on the snap exchange, picked back up by Byerly. But should we read much into the fact that Byerly is out there first instead of Justin Thomas?
We really shouldn't. Justin Thomas suffered a little bit of a bruised shoulder, I believe, in the last scrimmage. Didn't practice this week. Like I said, coaches have evaluated 14 practices so far. This is just most likely precautionary or just to see Byerly because he's got a little bit more rhythm with the offense this week.
Byerly's going to roll out and get a chance at his third pass, and that one drops in front of St. John Days, who went from the A-back slot out and could not complete it.
Byerly actually had DeAndre Smelter going up the sideline. It looked like the defense played a cover two shell. The corner stayed up. Smelter was able to get behind DJ White, or excuse me, Lynn Griffin over there on the right side of the field. He was able to get behind him. It looked like Byerly had a little window to throw it to him, but opted to go to St. John Days, and pass was falling incomplete.
So now it'll be third and 14. Lasky once again the B-back, and a pair of receivers split out wide. Dancing for his life, he tries to run for it as Byerly gets past the 40, but it's going to be fourth and about nine near the 35-yard line.
Byerly really wanted to come back to the weak side on a slant. You see him looking weak side, waiting for his guy to come open. Great job of escaping by him, able to break a couple of tackles and make something out of it, not get sacked in the backfield. Keep Harrison Butker in pretty decent field goal range. It's going to be a long field goal nonetheless.
Yeah, it is. 54 yards for Harrison Butker. His long last year was 49. Low line drive. Did he get it? Yes, he did. I'll tell you what, in a driving rain with some wind as well, that's a pretty good sign there from Butker.
Absolutely. The weather affects everybody, kickers as well. The ball's a little soggier. It doesn't travel as well, but see the kick here. It gets a little bit of help from the upright as it hits off of it and goes in between it.
A little kiss off the left upright, and the white has the first points. We're going to take a brief timeout, and we'll be right back with the rest of the action here on ESPN3. And welcome back with Roddy Jones. I'm Brandon Gauden. As play quickly resumes, you'll notice the timeout's not the usual length. They're going to try to go at a speedy pace as Donovan Wilson gets his first carry out of the backfield. And also, Roddy, we want to tell the viewers, we're probably not going to see a full four quarters here with the weather. Paul Johnson might call this early in the second half.
Certainly, no coach, no player likes to be out in weather like this, especially in the spring. But coaches don't either, and he's going to get as much as he needs to see, get enough on film, so that he can evaluate the final performance, and then they're gonna take it in.
Here goes Snotty. He caught a pitch to the right in the last series, this time going to the left and getting a level that time. That was Broderick Rook Chungong. Now, he missed 2013 with an injury to Chung Gong, but he's a guy they think, and you can see his size, they think he's going to contribute this year.
And you saw him get out to the sideline. And Broderick's not even one of the fastest guys. You saw him come off the block right there. Great job of not only defeating the block, but getting out to the sideline and tracking down one of the fastest players on Tech's team.
Chung Gong, a redshirt sophomore from Silver Springs, Maryland. And another fumble on the exchange. And a free football. We'll see who has it down at the bottom of the pile. White says they do. But it was recovered, as you can see there at the bottom, by Donovan Wilson and the Gold Squad.
Ty Griffin, you've seen the ball out a couple of times from him. That's the number one way to get in the doghouse of any head coach, is to put the football on the ground as a quarterback. You should just really focus on getting the exchange first and foremost. Let everything else come to it, but the exchange needs to be first, making sure you have the football.
Back to punt for the goal team, number 12, Will Summers.
We told you that Ryan Rodwell is the 1A or one punter here. Summers is kind of the 1A. You're going to see his first punt, redshirt freshman from Johns Creek, nearby to Tech, but a flag comes in before Summers can boot it. And a false start will back him up 5 yards.
Penalty. Still fourth down.
Well, he's off the field now, but let me ask you about Ty Griffin. You know, so much talk about either Byerly or Justin Thomas being the starting quarterback, but the coaches told us, Roddy, that Ty Griffin has done some good things so far in the spring.
And Ty Griffin may be the most talented of all the quarterbacks. A young guy, great arm, great legs. And as he grows into the offense and learns a little bit more about it, he's just going to continue to get better and better.
Summers with a pretty decent punt. And Smelter, who will, he had some return action last year, but he'll go back to being a secondary return option with Jamal Golden returning.
Jamal Golden, the year that he had a couple of years ago, was one of the best, not only in Tech history, but the best in the nation that year. Was just fantastic returning kicks and punts. So he'll be a welcome addition back, not only to Georgia Tech secondary, but certainly in the return game as well.
Saw Freddie Burton there, the center, number 58. He'll be battling for the starting center position after missing 2013 with a knee injury. And we are seeing our fourth fumble here already in this contest, thanks to the wet weather.
And certainly when you talk to Coach Johnson after the game, he's going to tell you it doesn't matter what the weather's like. You're going to have to play in it no matter what. This one, it looked like a little bit of a on the exchange, but Zach Lasky got hit quickly thereafter. Just looked like a straight fullback dive. That exchange was just a little bit off there.
Yeah, Lasky never had the football. He rushed for 485 yards last year and 7 touchdowns did Lasky, and yet again, an unclean exchange centered a quarterback.
And that's frustrating. It's frustrating as an offense when you can't even get a playoff. And when the ball's on the ground and comes quarterback to center, you really have no chance on the play, and you put yourself in these positions that no offense wants to be in, particularly an offense that this offense is built to be third and short. So you got to get chunks of yards on first and second down, and things like fumbles early in the downs, early in the possessions, really throw that off.
Yeah, it just hasn't looked like a typical Paul Johnson offense to this point, and a big part obviously due to the elements here. Now forced to pass on third and 13 and getting it away, dumping it off underneath the Lasky. He gets past the 40, but still well short of the first down.
Looks like a screen pass they tried to set up. Anticipated the strong blitz that they've been getting pretty much every third down, and that's what a lot of defenses like to do against this triple option offense. But Tim Byerly didn't even have enough time to let it get set up.
He had
to
release
that ball pretty quick. And Stargell was right on top of him, and Isaiah Johnson off the edge as well. Good open field tackle by Lynn Griffin as well.
And a good-looking punt by Ryan Rodwell. And a quick timeout for us. Back in just a few seconds with the resuming of the spring game, a gold wide of Georgia Tech here in Midtown Atlanta. On the flats with Roddy Jones, I'm Brandon Gauten. And the only point so far, a Harrison Butker field goal. It was an impressive field goal, though, of 54 yards. And 3-0 right now. White over the gold as Ty Griffin takes back over under center and gives the ball to Matt Connors for his third carry of the evening.
Matt Connors on the carry.
Third time we've seen that belly play out of the gold team. belly plays designed to get movement on the linebackers. You're able to trap one of the defensive linemen, hopefully get some movement up front to create a little bit of space for your B-back. That was the first time the White was really able to stop it for less than 7 yards, but still a 3-yard gain.
So this is the second team offense against the second team defense that you're seeing right here. And Griffin taking off on his own accord, getting to the 30, a nice run there by right now what most would consider the third string quarterback.
And the best thing that Ty Griffin does here is he plants his foot and gets upfield, makes a decision off of the pitch man, decides to take it up, and is able to get a nice 10-yard gain out of it.
And again, if you're wondering on the other side why you haven't seen Justin Thomas yet, as Roddy mentioned, he did have a minor injury in last Saturday's scrimmage. We're expecting to see him. He is dressed and on the sideline, but we'll see. And again, with the weather, they may be extra cautious. So we've only had a couple of first downs. You just saw the second one. And now it is first and 10 for the Gold Squad. And another give to the B-back Connors.
Brandon Connors on the carry.
Expect the B-backs to get a lot of work today.
Brought down by number 41.
One thing that the easiest to do is take a handoff, or take a snap and hand it off to the B-back. And when you have a guy who runs as hard as Matt Connors, why not take advantage of it?
Connors got 16 carries last year, just over 100 yards. Coming into his redshirt senior season, he's from nearby, went to the Marist School in Atlanta. He lines up again as the B-back. And Griffin is going to get swallowed up after faking the give. It looked like he wanted to pitch it out to Willis, and then he got hit hard. And leading the way defensively that time is Kashun Freeman, the young freshman, one of four true freshmen that have come here early.
And he's impressed this spring as well. The best thing probably happened to Ty Griffin on that play was getting hit so quickly. Had he decided to pitch that ball, he was going to pitch it right into a blitz. It looked like they tried to run the triple option into that strong blitz. Typically, you want to run it away from it so that you've got an opportunity to get the numbers that you're looking for. But that time decided to run it into it, and actually a good decision by Ty Griffin to eat that ball.
Ty Griffin trying to keep those hands dry. Rain not falling as hard as it was about 20 minutes ago, but still a steady shower. Griffin cannot escape the grasp that time of Bo Hankins. You know, getting back to Kashun Freeman, who we showed a second ago, who tackled Griffin. So that's one of four true freshmen that came early. And as we get another look at the most recent play where Hankins takes down Griffin. But they're trying to see if Freeman can play in that Itauchu role at the rush end. There's several guys, including Jabari Hunt-Days, that they're, I think they're just trying to piece together who can be the next Jeremiah Itauchu. And that's big shoes to fill, but it should be interesting to see this year.
It's huge shoes to fill. I mean, you're talking about the all-time leader in sacks for Georgia Tech history in Jeremiah Itauchu. You're just looking for guys that can get after the quarterback. They don't all have to be exactly like Jeremiah, but together you want to get the production out of him that you had last year. So Kashun Freeman, a guy who's really getting a leg up coming here in the spring. It's huge for a freshman to come in and get that time where you've got a lot of practice time, because once those guys show up in the fall, you've essentially got 29 practices to get ready to go play another team. So you don't really have the time to go through the learning curve that it really takes to be an effective freshman.
Still no Justin Thomas. It's still going to be Tim Byerly. And a hard hit there by P.J. Davis, jarring the ball loose. Now, Davis played a lot last year as a freshman, and he's obviously going to have a big impact role as a sophomore, and he made a big impact right there.
And we've seen that blitz through the B-gap a number of different times. Anytime you've got a trap like that where the linebacker is accounted for, but by a guy who's pulling or a guy that's coming around from an offensive line position, it's really dangerous when you get that strong side blitz coming into it.
So second and 10, and movement on the line. And the only question is trying to sort out whether it's on wide or goal.
Defense, it's a 5-yard penalty.
And it will be on goal to make it second and 5 instead of second and 10.
This Georgia Tech offense typically has a pretty fairly rhythmic, predictable snap count, and the ability to go on two is huge, especially when you get yourself in situations where you're second and long or even third and long.
St. John Days went in motion. And the old follow play that time. And showing some good wheels, something he's not necessarily known for, Tim Byerly.
And that play worked to perfection. A great block by St. John Days coming around on the midline lead. Led up on the linebacker. As you'll see him come around, he leads up on Paul Davis, opening the hole for Tim Byerly. And you see the strength of Tim Byerly running through the tackle of Quayshawn Neely. It's a big body running there up through the middle.
Roddy, you were an A-back here. You know that play well, don't you?
I do. I have lots of nightmares about that play. Those linebackers are big, man.
The fake on the handoff and then a pitch to the outside. And decent running room there for Tony Zenin. Now, Zenin only had 14 carries last year, but again, with God High gone, he figures to play a bigger role in 2014.
And this A-back group is going to kind of be A-back by committee. A little bit of a different look there. You had the twirl motion by St. John Days and then go back towards sideline by Tony Zenin. Great blocking on the perimeter and took the backside safety to have to bring him down.
Well, you mentioned nightmares about running that follow play from the A-back spot and having to block those linebackers, but you know, it goes without saying, and fans that follow Georgia Tech know this, as an A-back, that is such an instrumental part of this offense, is knowing not only how to carry the ball, but how to block for someone who's carrying the ball.
And, you know, you run 70 plays over the course of a game. As an A-back, you make it 6 to 10 carries. So those other 60 plays, what are you doing? You're blocking. You're blocking on the perimeter. You're leading up on linebackers. You're blocking defensive linemen. Those guys work extremely hard. And they're not always the biggest guys, but you gotta get after it.
Third and one. Byerly's going to keep it again. This time he went right behind Zach Lasky, the B-back. Still on his feet. And finally a swarm of gold brings him down after a good gain and a first down.
And we've seen in this drive, in the past couple of plays, this is the rhythm of the offense. This is how it's supposed to go. You get into third and one situations, and you run the little quarterback follow up the middle. And Tim Byerly keeps the chains moving by executing it well. Still not able to bring him down.
He was fighting hard, Byerly, 6 foot 215 from Alpharetta. Only threw four passes last year, but did have 119 rushing yards. Another opportunity that time for Zenin on the outside. Griffin and Neely were in on the tackle. There's Lynn Griffin.
And this secondary is going to be a very talented group. A little young in some spots. You've got two experienced safeties, but you see how physical Lynn Griffin, a big kid, very strong at cornerback, came in as a safety, but really a great tackler out there at the corner position.
Yeah, so you lose Jamia Thomas, who will likely go to the NFL, at least get a shot there. You lose Lewis Young, but we talked about getting Jamal Gold and Isaiah Johnson back, and then some of those other guys like Lynn Griffin, they're going to have to step up. Zach Lasky, who certainly figures to be a big part of Tech's offense again this year, getting the carry, running off the right side.
Even though Zach Lasky hasn't really started for the Yellow Jackets much over his career, he's played a whole lot, and he's a guy who coach really relies on. He runs hard, runs between the tackles, put on a little bit of weight over the course of this offseason, and really looking for big things this year.
Yeah, the old cliche, he just doesn't dance around with it. I mean, he goes straight when he gets that football, does Lasky. And he's getting it again here, and he's finding some open field, and we have our first touchdown in the spring game, and it goes to Zachary Lasky, right on cue.
Right on cue, and a great run by him. You saw a little bit of the wheels there at the end. Lasky actually returned some punts in his career as well. Showed the wheels, and a great job of him just staying on his feet, bouncing it, and then eventually got out the back door and was able to outrace everybody to the end zone.
Had seven rushing touchdowns last year and gets the first touchdown of the spring game this year. And Butker is on for the PAT. And by the way, when I say redshirt freshman, junior, senior, all these classes that I'm giving you will be for next year, anticipating the coming season as we get another look at one man who's going to be a big part of Tech in the coming year, and that's Zachary Lasky, making it 10-0 in favor of the White here on ESPN3. So the white has the first 10 points of the contest. Just four ticks remaining in the opening quarter. With Roddy Jones, I'm Brandon Gordon here in the booth at Bobby Dodd Stadium. 49 degrees and rainy. Not what the doctor ordered, but we're playing football nonetheless. And getting our first look at the young freshman at quarterback, Matthew Jordan from Jackson, Alabama, 6'2", 204, and this is the first series we've seen him, Roddy.
If you talk to people around the Georgia Tech camp about Matthew Jordan, they'll tell you that he's starting to feel a lot better about his role in the offense and what he's doing. There's a lot to swallow as a freshman coming in, especially as a quarterback. You have to know every position, but he's starting to feel more comfortable. Had a big run in the scrimmage last game, which really helped his confidence.
So that's the end of the first 15 minutes. And again, we can't guarantee you how much football we're going to see here in the second half. We know we're going to see a full two quarters, but given the weather and wanting to limit injuries, it's possible that Coach Paul Johnson in the early part of the second half could call things off and send the boys to the locker room, but we'll just have to wait and see.
Fans are invited to the first ever Georgia Tech Day at Six Flags Over Georgia on Sunday, June 15th.
I think what you're going to look to see in this second quarter as we continue is everybody just settle down a little bit. You'd like to see the ball off the ground a little bit more. Certainly, if you could go the rest of the game with no fumbles, no turnovers, you'd like to see that. But we saw the wide offense get into a little bit of a rhythm, start to stay on schedules, as they say, get some yardage on first down, yardage on second down, make it third and short so that you can continue to move the chains.
And something that we haven't discussed yet, Roddy, is Paul Johnson has said that he's switching his base defense to a 4-2-5. And he said, basically, he told you and I in a meeting the other day, that's because they looked at the tape and they realized about three-fourths of their snaps last year were in nickel defense, so why not make that your base?
Exactly. That kind of defense with the number of DBs and athletes you're putting on the field makes you a lot more multiple, as you'll see on that pass look and what we've seen a lot over the course of this game with the personnel and the formation that the offense runs here at Georgia Tech. You've seen a lot of what looks like kind of a 4-4 look. Almost looks like four linebackers that you see the ball on the ground another time, but the athleticism of Matthew Jordan makes something out of nothing, really, as he just takes and runs it. But it makes them very multiple. You can slide the defense into a lot of different looks. Five DBs. You can make it look like you've got three DBs and four linebackers. You can roll to cover two. It lets you do a lot of different things out of that defense with five DBs on the field.
So after Matthew Jordan's gain, he's back under center on third and three, and he's going to keep it again, and he's going to get the first down. Looking pretty mobile and good as the true freshman.
I think with Matthew Jordan in the game, you're going to see him keep it pretty simple. He's not going to make a whole lot of reads. This one, a design quarterback run, had no intentions of handing the ball off or passing it. Just keep it simple. Let him use his athleticism.
It was the 28th ranked prospect out of the state of Alabama was Matthew Jordan this last year. Of course, finished up high school early in December, getting his diploma and coming to start his college career on the flats.
Talking to Georgia Tech great Joe Hamilton, you know, when you talk about these freshmen, he'll tell you these guys are supposed to be going to prom right now, not playing D1 college football.
Matthew Jordan's first throw is a little bit of a wobbler. I don't know if that was tipped. I don't think it was. I think it just came out of his hand wrong.
And what it looked like to me is just by the route and kind of the way he reacted, he kind of predetermined where he was going to go with that ball and saw it wasn't going to quite work out the way he thought and tried to pull up because Dennis Andrews looked like he was going to come open a little bit, but that backside safety was able to get over there. And had he thrown a good ball, it might have been intercepted.
So number 41, Austin McClellan, the A-back, bringing the play from the sideline. McClellan at one A-back, and the other, Isaiah Willis, number 29 on the left side, and going in motion there. Pressure coming from behind, and down goes Jordan. It was a combination there. Leading the way defensively was number 48, Nick Minicol, the defensive end.
Nick Minicol is a guy who's been around the program for a while, really knows the offense, is able to defeat a block there.
And then
A-back wasn't quite able to get him hooked. Great job of him keeping contained, forcing the quarterback to bubble around. And defense is able to rally. Bring down for a loss.
Second nice play there by Bo Hankins, who cleaned up the job and played a lot of special teams last year, did Hankins, but he figures to see a little bit more at the linebacker position this season. Another opportunity for Jordan to show the arm, and instead he's going to try to show the legs. And he gets to the 45, well short.
Matthew Jordan on the carry.
We talked about the fact that this offense isn't necessarily built for third and long. No offense is built for third and long. You look at the percentages across the country, it's just not great. But defense dropped back, only rushed four on this one. Was able to cover everything down. And good job of bringing down the athletic Matthew Jordan.
Was that a designed run, or did he just not see anything and ran with it?
It looked like it was not a designed run. He actually had a route going on downfield, so he just tucked it and ran. A good decision by him, not trying to force the ball. But just not able to get the first down.
Second punt by Will Summers. And again, in these spring games, nobody rushes the punter. So that's why you see the inactivity there. And the fair catch by DeAndre Smelter. Back with more coverage of the Georgia Tech spring game in a moment. Andy, can you hear me? Can you ask Andy... So the white team comes back on offense, leading 10-0. A touchdown run by Zach Lasky and a long field goal by Harrison Butker. That's how we got to the mark where we're at right now, with a little over 12 remaining. And the first reception to DeAndre Smelter there as he dances across the 30.
Byerly's pass complete to number 15.
DeAndre Smelter, of course, came on the scene in a big way last season, Roddy, and now you feel like he's poised for a huge year at that position.
He really is. It's a little bit of a shame that he missed a lot of the spring with an ankle injury, but picking up right where he left on that slant, he and Tim Byerly seemingly have a great connection as they were able to complete the pass right there.
Still no Justin Thomas as a pitch to Zinnan running around the right side. Got a block by Bostic and cleared the 40 for another first down.
We talked about the ability to block for these A-backs, but on the edge, the receivers as well have to be able to block. You see DeAndre Smelter coming in and drilling Jamal Golden, putting him on the ground. And then Tony's in and making somebody miss the open field for the big game.
Give to Lasky, but not much there as a swarm of gold brings him down after about a yard.
Coach Johnson likes to do that a lot. He likes to run a play like the sweep and then run action and act like he's running the same play, make it look like it, and then run a play off of it like the belly, as you saw right there. So we see Georgia Tech getting into a little different tempo now, kind of a check with me sort of on the line and then determine what you're going to run.
He's former Georgia Tech A-back Roddy Jones. I'm Brandon Gunn. Thanks for watching here on ESPN3. Tim Byerly, former Middle Tennessee State player, transferred into Georgia Tech, played last year, now this year, keeping it and getting near midfield. Quayshawn Neely, whose name you'll hear a ton this season, number 54 there in gold with a tackle. Certainly a lot of questions, Roddy, on both the defensive line and the offensive line, but for the purposes of the offensive line, as they try to push forward Lasky for a couple more yards. Of course, you lost Finch, Jackson, and Bino. Shaq Mason has a big load on his shoulders. He is kind of the anchor on the offensive line, but some other guys are going to have to step up this year.
They certainly are. And you lost three good players in those three guys that you mentioned, but also you lost three guys who played a lot for this Georgia Tech team. And when you lose that, you lose the experience, you lose knowing what they're going to do and being able to deal with the different situations that you're faced with. And that you just don't get with freshmen overnight.
Another good use of the legs there by Byerly.
Tim Byerly on the keeper.
Well, I know they have, talking about the center position, some good hope for big number 58, Freddie Burden, as you get another look at Byerly's run.
Another design quarterback run. The line was able to collapse the right side so that Byerly was able to get around and get upfield.
But again, Burden is the center out there with the first team offense again on this drive. And a pitch to the outside for Zinnan.
It looked like Tony couldn't quite get his feet up under him as he came around, but a great read there by Tim Byerly. That's what we call a pull pitch. He sees the read key coming down. He pulls it quickly and then pitches it immediately because the pitch key is coming down as well. Tony Zinnan not quite able to outrun Paul Davis to the corner, but great read by Tim Byerly.
So first and 10. And the follow play, St. John Days leads the way, and Byerly gets down just outside of the 20. That's the advantage of that 6'2", 235-pound frame of St. John Days.
When you have a guy like that at A-back, you want him matched up against those guys. But St. John didn't even really do a lot until he got up to safety level, and that's a testament to the offensive line being able to block those guys up front so that the A-backs can lead up on safeties.
That's true. I think I gave him a little too much credit for being a good lead blocker there. Being B.J. Bostic with a hair hanging out of the back of the helmet with a carry.
And it looks like this is exactly what you want to see from the wide offense. You see a rhythm going. You see them starting to flow. You start to feel like they're getting their legs under them and really starting to get into the rhythm of the game, or in this case, the scrimmage.
Standard base formation here for the Jackets. And Byerly coughs it up. Isaiah Johnson picks it up, and he's going to scamper the other way. And nobody is going to catch him. Isaiah Johnson back this year after sitting out 2013 with a torn ACL. And how about that? A fumble recovery, and he takes it to the house.
Coach Roof preaches turnovers, and he preaches scoop and score, and that's the epitome of it. Tim Byerly just not holding onto the ball tightly enough, the ball popping out. Isaiah Johnson, great job being Johnny on the spot, taking that ball and putting it in the end zone.
He was a guy, Roddy, that they tried to get back last year, but he just never felt 100% healthy. And I'll tell you what, selfishly for Tech, this now being his senior season coming up with what they lost, it's great to have him and his veteran leadership back there.
It is, and that stuff is invaluable when you talk about a safety, a guy who's going to get guys lined up, a guy who's played a lot in Isaiah Johnson and really has a maturity in the respect of his teammates.
Fumbling the snap there, Rodwell, he couldn't get it down. It would have been the first attempt for Roberto Hinojosa, who's in his first season trying to compete for the kicking job. But what we saw a moment ago was the fumble by Byerly, the redshirt senior Isaiah Johnson picking it up, heading the other direction for 6 points and getting the gold team on the board. Now they're within four in the spring game here on the flats in 2014. So the Gold scored a touchdown but failed to convert on the extra point. So they trail by four as the white team takes back over following the Byerly fumble. And St. John Days getting the carry.
And fumbles are not only drive killers but the momentum killers as well. This white offense was in a rhythm. And they were looking like they were really getting into the game. And hate to see a drive like that be derailed by a fumble.
We just saw brother tackle brother on that last play as Jabari Hunt Days brought down St. John. This time Byerly, some time in the pocket and just beyond the outstretched arms of McInerney from that A-back spot.
Byerly making a great read on that. A little bit of a switch route. The outside receiver runs a post. The A-back runs a wheel up the sideline. Byerly making a great throw. Sam McInerney just not able to dive far enough or bring that ball in.
Back at the A-back slot on third down and four. But toward the top of your screen, you see St. John Days and White at the A-back and his brother across from him at rush in, Jabari Hunt Days, as the quarterback keeps and gets to the 44 for a first down.
And another designed quarterback keeper there by Tim Byerly. Seen that play be very effective.
It's first and 10
over the course
for the
of the day-to-day. But that play is really unstoppable if you run it well against any defense and at any time.
You got to look at Paul Johnson standing in the raindrops. He will be coming up on his seventh season as the head coach of the Yellow Jackets. Each school, by NCAA rule, gets 15 spring practice sessions. Tech been going at it for just under a month, and this will, of course, as all the spring games do, round out the spring session. That time, Byerly had nowhere to go.
See Quayshawn Neely again getting penetration. We've seen them run that blitz a number of different times, and it seems like each time it creates havoc in the Georgia Tech backfield.
By the way, when you see guys that have jerseys with no numbers on them, as you do on the top of your screen, or toward the top of your screen on the end, that is because he started on the white squad, switched to the gold, and they don't give him a numbered jersey after they switch. There's a long pass completion that time to Corey Dennis.
Great throw by Byerly. You saw Dennis rolling back. That's called the back shoulder throw. Corey Dennis is running down the sideline, and Tim Byerly throws this where only his receiver can make a play on it. As you see Corey Dennis fading away from the defender and able to make that catch on the sideline.
Dennis still yet to catch a pass in his Tech career. Came on as a defensive back as a freshman, then wide receiver the last two seasons, but making a nice catch there on the throw from Byerly. And back the action goes to Zach Lasky with a carry.
Brought down by number 35, Tyler Marcordes.
Lasky's really run well so far in this game. Just consistent. He's been very consistent over the course of his career here. He's going to be a consistent runner, downhill guy, no nonsense. One cut and go.
Days a back left, McNierney a back right. He goes in motion. Byerly gets hit as he flips it, and McNierney just has to jump on it. But boy, Tyler Marcordes just cleaned the clock of Tim Byerly.
Sometimes that's the role of a quarterback here at Georgia Tech. He made a great read on it and waited to the last second to pitch this ball. Sam McNierney just not able to haul it in, but he had some running room had he been able to get there. He had the first wave pretty much beat. All he had to do was cut it upfield.
I was so worried about Byerly getting drilled, I wasn't even watching the fumble. Boy, that big number 35, Tyler Marcordes, who had a pair of interceptions last year at the linebacker spot with a big tackle. Now third and 10. And a little beyond the reach that time as he was trying to get it to Brandon Oliver.
You like what you saw out of the route. Throw was just a little bit off by Byerly, but he put it on the sideline where only his guy was going to be able to get it. So not a bad throw there by Tim Byerly.
Harrison Butker converted from 54 yards earlier when he was kicking the other direction to the north. Now he'll try to boot this thing to the south, and it'll be a 45-yard field goal. So certainly no chip shot, especially given the elements. And Butker this time misses it to the left. So the score remains white 10 and gold 6 here on the Georgia Tech spring game on ESPN3. Welcome back to Bobby Dodd Stadium. As we get down inside of 5 minutes remaining in the second quarter. Here in the booth, Brandon Gaud with Roddy Jones, Sean Bedford on the sidelines. And back at the quarterback position, Ty Griffin handing it off to Connors. He ran straight up the gut. Got about 8 yards before he received any contact.
That was a great job out of the line up front. See the movement that Shamir Devine's able to get on that three technique at guard. Great job by him. Big, big, big guy. You can see how big he is compared to the other offensive linemen. But a great job of getting movement by him, just really opening up the hole for Matt Connors.
This time Griffin trying to dance to the outside. Finally pushed out of bounds. Patrick Gamble tried to bring him down from behind, couldn't catch him.
And that's the athleticism of Ty Griffin. Looked like he was caught in the backfield a couple of different times, but able to get away from the rush. As you'll see here, it's away from one guy. Pat Gamble tries to bring him down, squirt through, and is able to get a first down out of it.
But a second ago, you mentioned, and you can see him there, Shamir Devine, number 71, 370 pounds. You got him at the guard spot. You should be able to run behind him, right?
It's huge.
And a combination tackle this time.
Ty Griffin on the keeper.
Coming from Technip. And also defensively helping on the tackle that time was Kashawn Freeman, number 42 you just saw there on your screen.
Biggest thing Kashawn Freeman has going for him is his athleticism. He's just a defensive end. He came in highly touted, but very athletic guy, and a guy that'll continue to develop as he gets in the weight room over the course of the summer, gets to the training table, starts eating right. You're going to see him put on a good 10 to 15 pounds and maybe even as much as 20 to 30 over the course of his career.
And Technip, who helped on that tackle, you'll see him in nickel situations. A fumble, and the White says they have it, and they do indeed. The cough up and another turnover. And who comes up with it at the bottom of that pile? That's the aforementioned Technip.
Tyler Technip. On this one, Jimmy Kitchens comes free, avoids the block. It looks like the center was trying to get up to the next level. A little bit of miscommunication there. Someone's supposed to scoop the backside, which is take care of Jimmy Kitchens so that he doesn't have a free run at the B-back. But Kitchens able to get through the line and hits Matt Connors hard to cause the fumble. Great job by him.
It's first and 10 for the White team. Ball on the 42-yard line.
Kitchen, the Lithonia, Georgia native, and now the White team takes over inside of Gold territory, leading 10-6. And another follow play here for Byerly, the quarterback.
Tim Byerly, and that follow was blown up by Tremaine McNair. He met Zach Lasky in the hole and drove him back into Tim Byerly. A lot of this offense is predicated on rhythm, and the rhythm is quarterback fakes the handoff, is able to get around the B-back and get into the hole, get his shoulder square. But when you blow it up in the backfield like that, quarterback can never get going.
It's a good linebacking crew. McNair hoping for increased playing time this year. Anthony Harrell is still out with the injury, but he figures to be back by the fall. And then Quayshawn Neely, of course. It's a pretty good crew, and we haven't mentioned a young freshman. We haven't seen much of him to this point, but Trey Jackson certainly figures into the linebacker corps at some point.
He definitely does. The linebacker corps is going to be one of the more experienced crews on this Georgia Tech defense. You talk about the guys that you just mentioned, along with Paul Davis and
yep.
Tyler Marcordes. And I mean, Jabari Hunt Days, the linebacker who's so loaded, they moved to linebacker, to defensive end, to get more talent on the field.
Lasky had a long touchdown run earlier, and here he's breaking tackles to the 25.
You see the strength of Zach Lasky. Able to grind out a couple of more yards, spinning with some defenders. And it's just going to be a tough guy to bring down over the course of the year. He's a guy who likes to punish defenders. He runs, they say, call him running angry. Punishes it, looks for the hit, looks to deliver the hit to them.
You know what the most ironic thing about Zach Lasky's power running game is, Roddy, is that before the game he listens to Taylor Swift to get pumped up. That is factual. That is not a lie. He runs with the anger of Taylor Swift.
There's a lot of anger in her songs as well.
Second down and 10.
As you saw the intended play there for Tony Zinnen.
And that's a different dimension that we've seen out of Georgia Tech. The ability to dump it off to the A-back if nothing's open downfield. He had the switch route going on downfield. Didn't see anything. Just dump it off and maybe get a couple of yards out of it.
You mentioned it about 15 minutes ago, but if folks weren't watching, what's the intention there where they bring the A-back quickly to the quarterback, pause, and then everybody goes back?
You want to see what the defense is going to do. You hope that they'll tip their hand. So you send the motion like you're going to run the play, and maybe they show you a blitz so that you can get going in the right play. And the thought is that you audible to your play quicker than they can audible out of what they're running, so that they're stuck in what they're running and you're able to get the best play set up.
It did not work there for the White team, though, as we are now down inside of a minute here in the first half. And it'll be a wait and see determining how much football we play in half number two here. It certainly figures that we won't play a full four quarters because of the weather.
And that's really the first time we've seen on a third and long Georgia Tech run the ball. And typically what you see on the third and long is you see a blitz out of the defense. And in that situation, if you have an option call, that was not an option. That was a designed quarterback run. But if you have an option call, you run it to the weak side away because you think you're going to get a strong blitz, something that slants the defensive line into the boundary so you get a handoff and you're able to get some yards before the defense can really react.
Harrison Butker's going to come on. He made from 54, then missed from 45. And now he's getting ready to attempt from 40 yards.
On to attempt the field goal, number 87, Harrison Butker.
The rain has been steady, and it continues to be so. In fact, it's picked up a little bit in the last 10 minutes. Rodwell, the punter, will be the holder, like Poole was last year. And this time, Harrison Butker splits him evenly.
The 40-yard field goal is good.
So he has scored 6 points, and he puts the white up by 7. 13-6 is the score after the right leg of Harrison Butker boots it through. Indeed, it is raining, as it has been all evening. First half in the books at the Georgia Tech spring game. The white up 13-6 over the gold. And we'll see some highlights from the first half, led by a nice tackle here by Quayshawn Neely, the linebacker. And from deep out in the line drive on the right leg of Harrison Butker from 54 yards with a kiss off the left upright. And then finally, we got our first touchdown about 10 minutes in, as Zach Lasky, who had 7 touchdowns last year, breaks free and takes it to the house. And then a turnover by the quarterback, Byerly, coughed up into the hands of Isaiah Johnson. He is off to the races. And that was the lone touchdown and all of the 6 points for the gold in the first half here at Bobby Dodd Stadium. Alongside Roddy Jones in the booth, I'm Brandon Gauden, and Even Buzz is wet down there, Roddy. The weather has made things ugly, but what were your first half impressions?
Well, other than the turnovers and the ball on the ground, you saw some good things. I think the good thing about the spring game is that no matter what happens, there's good on one side or the other. But we saw some good blocks. We saw the white offense start to get into a little bit of a rhythm, being able to move the ball, get into those third and short situations where we saw a lot of quarterback keepers design runs up the middle to move the chains. So going into the second half, you want to see a little bit of the eliminated mistakes. But more than anything, you want to see blocking and tackling the fundamentals continue.
And it remains to be seen how much of the second half we will play. Again, Coach Johnson can cut it off at any moment. And we were told before the game that it's likely he will do that sometime in the third or early fourth quarter. But I think he just wants to at least get everybody out there for a series or two. And we'll see how the second half goes, as it will be the gold team starting out on the 30. Again, no kickoffs here in the spring game. Quick pass out to the left, that time from Ty Griffin. Completing it to Darren Waller. First catch on the evening for number 88.
Really the first time we've mentioned Darren Waller's name, a guy who's going to be a big part of this Georgia Tech offense. Suspended for the first two games of the season, but once he comes back, he's a big receiver who really has played a lot for this Georgia Tech team.
Receiver is really not a question mark this year at all, is it?
It's really not. You got... the guys that we've mentioned earlier, DeAndre Smelter, Darren Waller, Michael Summers is coming back to play some more. Anthony Autry's coming off an injury. So a really deep receiver core for this Georgia Tech offense.
Another nice play by Tyler Tecna, who figures to factor in those nickel situations of 4-2-5 and coming in for a nice tackle there of Griffin.
Seeing the depth that Georgia Tech has at defensive back. Not just amongst the gold squad, which would be the first team, but also on the white squad, guys that can factor in and play if you get in a situation where a guy goes down. You have to build that depth, especially at a position where you're going to be playing five guys at one time.
The redshirt freshman, Ty Griffin, on the carry. Past the 35 to about the 36. Ty Griffin tackled by Corey Griffin on that last play.
Another design quarterback run. This one a little bit further off tackle for Ty Griffin. You've seen the gold team kind of simplify it for Matthew Jordan and Ty Griffin, kind of taking the guesswork out of it, not putting them in a position where they have to make a lot of reads. Just let them use their athleticism, dictate the throws, dictate where they're going to go with the football.
Will Summers with his third punt. And everything a fair catch here in the spring game. DeAndre Smelter joking with his teammate Darren Waller, fellow wide receiver. It's all jokes and a lot of raindrops. And right now it's 13-6 in favor of the White. Now the White crew comes back on, and we'll start this drive at the 23 on the left hash.
First and 10 for the white team.
And I'm starting to think, Roddy, we haven't seen Justin Thomas to this point. I'm not sure we're going to see him at all in this one.
If we haven't seen him by now, and this guy saw him a little bit in warm-ups at this point in time, probably said it wasn't feeling great for him. He and Tim Byerly are supposed to be on opposite teams, but Tim Byerly switching over to the white team at the last minute and starting at quarterback for him, so his spring is likely done.
Saw Sean Green, nose tackle from Grayson, coming in there for the tackle.
And if Sean Green can stay healthy over the course of this year, it's been a little bit of an issue for him over the course of his career. As you see Tim Byerly showing off the wheels a little bit.
Ooh, taking a hard tumble over there into the bench. Pops up okay.
If Sean Green can stay healthy, he's really going to be a force in the middle with Adam Gotsis, the middle of this Tech defense. Played a lot of good experience, very athletic guy. Not the biggest in terms of height or size, but really plays hard.
Well, at the top of the broadcast, we talked about how Justin Thomas is a better runner and Byerly a better passer, but at least today, Byerly showed himself a decently capable runner.
And in talking to some of the coaches, Byerly's not the guy that's going to break a 70-yard run. He's going to get a lot of 10, 15-yard runs. And you saw that one right there. Essentially, there was no pitch key on that, so he takes the ball and runs it. I mean, you know, Justin Thomas is in the game. It's possibly that one. It's 30, 40, 50 yards, but Byerly's going to consistently get you that 10 to 15-yard run, which in this offense is really all you need.
Second down and 8 after that 2-yard gain by Lasky. Coming from the backside, Mark Cordes makes a sandwich out of Tim Byerly.
Tyler Mark Cordes is a guy that the coaches are really excited about. You'll see him coming off the backside, defeats a block, gets up, and gets after Tim Byerly in the backfield. Big linebackers, put on a lot of weight. Guy who came on as a walk-on. Ted Roof really likes him out there at linebacker and looks to factor in and be a big part of this Georgia Tech defense.
First game last year, he had a 95-yard pick and return to the house. And another interception as well later in the season did Mark Cordes. And with a sack, it's now 3rd and 15. Byerly forced to throw. And a nice strike that time. There's a first catch by Michael Summers.
Byerly's pass complete to number 84, Michael Summers.
Part of that deep receiving core that Roddy and I talked about a moment ago.
Best thing that Tim Byerly does, you see him, going to see him set up and deliver this ball over to the sideline, hitting Michael Summers. Simple pitch and catch. Summers runs a little comeback route to the sideline, sets up, and Byerly's able to hit him right there.
Summers had 10 receptions last year for a little over 200 yards. He started out gangbusters in the Eli game, 3 catches for 79 yards. A little quiet the rest of the season, but certainly will be a factor in 2014. Byerly keeping it and coming up from the backfield, Isaiah Johnson.
Byerly on the keeper.
Nice play by Isaiah, reading the fact that that wasn't a run. There's no that wasn't a pass, no receivers coming out, so comes up from his safety spot, really into the backfield to make that play. Good job of him. He had run support responsibilities coming into the play, but once he read that there was no threat to pass, took the lane he was given and made that play in the backfield.
So coming from the secondary to the backfield to make the tackle earlier, Johnson had the fumble recovery and the return for 6 points. It's the only 6 points that the gold team has so far. Give up the middle. Lasky, boy, I thought he was down. Somehow he always stays on his feet. They still haven't brought him down to the turf.
Lasky on the carry.
It's the strength of Lasky. And he runs with that forward lean. And when you run with a lean like that and a guy meets you, a lot of times you just get stood up because he can't get lower than you can't get down around your legs. Just see where the contact is made and how low he stays. Guys just aren't able to bring him down. He's always fighting for more yards.
And as a former running back yourself, even when you know you're not going any further, is it a little bit of a pride thing there to just stay up and say, you can't even bring me down no matter how many guys you have?
It absolutely is. And then after the play, even when they blow the play dead, you get up and – or you don't have to get up. You just walk back to the huddle thinking, yeah, they still couldn't bring me down.
Another nice carry by Byerly.
And this one actually is an option. Tucks it up, breaks the tackle off the pitch key. Great job by Byerly. You've seen – he's another guy, north-south runner. He's not going to make too many moves. He's not going to string it out towards the sideline. He's going to get positive yards, and it's been effective today.
Now on first and 10, taken down by Quayshon Neely is Tim Byerly.
Brought down by Quayshon Neely.
But we're starting to see a couple of these typical Paul Johnson drives from the white team where they really eat up some clock, work it down methodically.
And the decision-making by Tim Byerly has been really great. You haven't seen many pitches out of this, but we've seen a lot of triple options. That right there was a triple option. That pitch key comes too far upfield, so Byerly doesn't hesitate. He puts his foot in the ground and gets upfield.
Byerly that time ran into Lasky, but was able to keep the football, get down inside the 15. As he bumped heads a little bit with a B-back before moving it upfield.
Someone's going to get in trouble out in the film room for not hitting the right spot. But, again, just a positive gain. Another 5-yard gain. And 2 5-yard gains of first down. That's all you ask for.
We're expecting a crowd of about 10,000 and fireworks after. Unfortunately, neither coming to fruition here this evening with temperatures in the upper 40s and heavy rain continuing to fall. But carrying on with the spring game in the third quarter, White up 13-6.
Tackle made by Quayshawn Neely.
And you see the raindrops continuing to fall on the sidelines. Lasky gets another carry. Sean Bedford, by the way, we mentioned that he's on the sidelines for us. He was going to talk to any former players that were going to come. We were expecting some of your former guys, Roddy, were supposed to be here, but there's Sean Bedford.
There's Jonathan Dwyer next to him, so we got one here.
We got one that has braved the elements. But we had a nice star-studded cast lined up to talk to Sean Bedford in our dull moments, but unfortunately, because of the weather, a lot of them opted to not make it out. Mark Cortez with another tackle.
No gain on the play.
Seen a very active linebacker core. Quayshawn Neely, I think, has certainly been one of the defensive standouts, as you'd expect him to be. I mean, a guy coming in who's played a ton over the course of his career. He's been an impact player for Georgia Tech. You'd expect him to have a great scrimmage here today, and he has. And you see Tyler Marcorda starting to get in on the action as well.
Byerly's going to drop this time. Dump it out on the left side for Lasky. Spinning down to the five.
Byerly's pass complete to Zach Lasky.
Pretty good catch there by Lasky, showing a little athleticism with the one-hander. So that he has the hands coming out of the backfield as well. This is a designed throw to the B-back. You just have the trips out on that side, run everybody off, clear out the flat so that the B-back can catch it and hopefully get some. And you saw this is a typical Carl Johnson drive. You see him going for it on fourth down, down close to the goal line.
And the Jackets able to get the first down of the Byerly keeper before the Stargell tackle. You see Paul Johnson coming in and talking with his offense. It'll be first and goal on the three. And by the way, we mentioned Sean Bedford down there with Jonathan Dwyer. He's going to talk to him at the conclusion of this drive, so stay tuned for that. Michael Summers switching sides from left to right, going into the slot receiver role. Lasky already has one touchdown. He can't get number two on that play.
That time was the defensive lineman just crabbing down, staying low, crabbing, creating a pile. And Zach Lasky not able to get around it or over it to get into the end zone. And this is where the quarterback keeper really comes into play, because those defensive linemen cause those piles, so you get a lead blocker with the B-back and then have the quarterback follow through. We'll see if they go to it here. It's been pretty successful for him so far.
As the white team tries to add to that one score advantage. Roddy Jones dialed it up correctly. And the white team, did they get it in for six? Yes. Touchdown, Tim Byerly on the keeper.
Tim Byerly's ability to run in the short yardage situations has really proven. Keep this Georgia Tech offense in rhythm. He did a great job on that one. Just a quarterback sneak up the middle. Saw a little gap and was able to take it. But great job by Byerly of just moving the chains. We talked about keeping the turnovers and the ball off the ground. He was able to do it there. And you see there, you stay on schedule and keep the ball off the ground, you're able to move the ball and good things happen.
Butker with the PAT. He already has two field goals and a pair of point after touchdowns to make it 20-6.
See nobody lined up over the center. And typically a Paul Johnson quarterback has the option. No matter what, if nobody's lined up over the center, just take the quarterback sneak, especially that close to the end zone. And Tim Byerly did it there.
Well, we haven't had Sean Bedford as a part of this broadcast yet, but that's about to change. Let's head down to Sean Bedford, who's down on the field with Jonathan Dwyer.
Well, it's a rainy, cold night here at Bobby Dodd Stadium, but it's my pleasure to offer a warm welcome back to the 2008 ACC Player of the Year, Jonathan Dwyer. We just announced Jonathan's name and suddenly we get highlights over here. But Jonathan is someone who's one of the newest Arizona Cardinals. Are you expecting a lot of weather like this?
Not at all. It doesn't rain too much. The only thing there is sandstorms.
Well, I don't know which is worse, but I know a lot of the fans here are excited to see you back, and I think a lot of people, when they look back on your career, think of all the highlight runs and running over people, running through defenders. Are there any memories that stand out to you of your time here at Georgia Tech?
Probably, you know, the run against Virginia, the big play we had at UGA when we beat UGA, and obviously the game winner in the ACC championships.
Well, Jonathan, obviously you're playing a little bit of a different position now in the league, but when you look back at the lessons you learned here, what stands out as the lessons you've carried over that have helped you to be successful in your NFL career?
Outside of just being a football player, probably the biggest thing is mental toughness and playing with effort. That's something that Coach Johnson, you know, is a big thing for us to do here, and he emphasizes it over and over and over, and, you know, it makes you a better person on and off the field.
Well, Jonathan, thank you for your time. We appreciate you being out here to support the Jackets, and go get warm.
All right, that is Sean Bedford down there talking with Jonathan Dwyer. Thanks to Jonathan. Thanks for Sean for battling the raindrops. As we saw a nice run a second ago while those guys were talking by Ty Griffin, he takes the snap again and gives it off to Connors getting inside the 30.
Connors on the carry.
I don't think there's any mistaking Ty Griffin's athleticism out there. You saw him break the long run. He's another guy that's going to be a big play threat when he gets his shot at quarterback, and he will over the course of the year and during his career here at Tech. He's going to be an exciting player to watch once he really takes the ranks.
So you know Jonathan Dwyer well, I would imagine, right?
I do. He and I were roommates.
Oh, wow.
Roommates here at Georgia Tech, absolutely. So I know him a little bit. And
he's you got any now, stories you want to share?
Not on the air, but... Well, Jonathan's a great guy, and I'm happy for them getting a shot out there at Arizona. He's wearing my old number, number 20 out there. You know, he was 21 here at Georgia Tech, so I told him, I texted him, said, hey, you got to represent if you're wearing number 20, and he assured me that he was going to.
He's Roddy Jones. Thanks for watching the Georgia Tech spring game. I'm Brandon Gauden. 20-6 in favor of the White. The only touchdown for the Gold was in the defensive variety when Isaiah Johnson recovered a fumble and took it into the end zone for a touchdown. Now they try to get one of the offensive variety. Going back the other way, Griffin dancing to the outside, and just clipping him by the ankles that time was Chris Milton to prevent him from going to the house.
I think if you ask anybody in this Georgia Tech team, Chris Milton, one of the fastest guys on the field, but watch this play by Ty Griffin coming out of the pile. And the athleticism to get out the back door took one of the fast guys, and he still almost got to the end zone. Ty Griffin has really been the engine for this Georgia Tech drive by the Gold team.
And that was the first time we called Chris Milton's name. You mentioned the speed of the cornerback, who certainly will be a key part of the secondary in 2014. Connors, no dice.
Connors on the carry.
That time it was the penetration of the defensive line led by number 53, Chase Alford. Talked to guys on the team. They really respect Chase Alford. He's a guy who came to Georgia Tech as a walk-on. His family's big Georgia Tech family. And guy who works hard, is talented, and they think he'll see a lot of special teams time over the course of this year. And maybe even work himself into seeing some time with the ones.
There he is in the middle of your screen. His brother Corey has graduated, was also a member of the Yellow Jacket team. As flags come flying in for a false start.
You can't do that down near the goal line. That's the frustrates you. There's a few things that frustrate you as a coach, but nothing more than getting a false start when you're down inside the five. I mean, you're turning a second and goal at the 3 and a second and goal at the 8. It just totally changes the feel of the drive and the momentum. And we saw Coach Johnson a little bit. He gets frustrated by those things, and he's not afraid to show it.
Although he was smiling for a brief second there after that 5-yard penalty. If this was against Virginia Tech in October, that smile's not there.
Not at all. And Coach Johnson stands behind the offense, doesn't really help either team unless he takes over a play call that he'd like to see out of one guy or another, but typically just stands and takes it all in.
Isaiah Willis tried to evade the tacklers but could not.
Isaiah Willis on the carry.
one of the first times we've seen Ty Griffin in that position where he makes the pitch. And on this one, you'll see he had a little bit of a lane. You see the pitch man kind of trying to play in between Chris Milton. He's pitching off of Chris, and Chris never really committed. So in that situation, what you'd like to see the freshman quarterback is put his foot in the ground, attack the inside shoulder, and make Chris Milton make a decision and possibly take it himself for positive yardage.
Three quarters in the books, and it looks like we're going to try to at least start the fourth. We'll see how far we get through it given the weather, but it's 20 for White and 6 for the Gold after three full at Bobby Dodd. The old Buzz is Wiser cheer going on here in between the third and fourth quarters per usual at Bobby Dodd Stadium. Even at the spring game, even in the rain, it goes on. Those poor cheerleaders.
They're toughing it out today. I certainly do not envy their position being down there on the sideline. Cheering for all 17 fans that are standing in front of them. Most of the fans are pushed back underneath the overhangs here at Bobby Dodd Stadium.
The smart ones, at least.
Yeah.
We're dry. We're lucky. We're up in the booth with a bird's eye view as we begin the fourth quarter with the Gold looking for their first offensive touchdown. They're 6 points on a defensive score earlier. And going for the back of the end zone, and we're going to have pass interference here. Defending Darren Waller that time was number 44, and it was...
That's Dennis Oldowale.
Pass interference. Defense. Number 44. Half the distance to go. Automatic first down.
Indeed it was on Walla, but that's a mismatch for certain with the size of Darren Walla versus on Walla.
It certainly is, and what you'd like to see out of Ty Griffin is him putting the ball in a position where Walla can go make a play no matter what, but you talk about Walla, a guy who's 6'4", 6'5", up against any cornerback, it's a mismatch, but on the Walla's got to turn around and make a play on the ball or else he's going to get that call every time.
So now first and goal, and Ty Griffin goes nowhere on the keeper.
They turned somebody loose on Ty Griffin that time. He expected Chase Alford to be blocked by somebody, picked up by typically the B-back or someone leading through, but that time he got no help.
They switched jerseys on me with Dennis Onwalla. He was supposed to have 36 on. I knew I wasn't crazy when I looked up. I said, there's no 44 on this roster. Get sports information director Dean Buchan up here now. Flags fly in.
Start offense, 5-yard penalty.
Once again, this number two offense getting a false start penalty. That's what derailed the last play. They were in the exact same position, second and goal on the 3-yard line. And then you get pushed back with the penalty. Then they had a play for no gain, the pitch for no gain, and you end up having to throw a lob pass to Darren Wall in the end zone, fortunately getting a pass interference call for a first down. But it kind of looks like deja vu here.
Seems like they've been in the red zone for a year and a half. See what Ty Griffin does with it this time. Nothing. He swarmed from behind that time. And a good tackle by Kashun Freeman.
Mentioned his name a lot today. He's been all over the field in the backfield and really putting together a nice resume in his first spring here at Georgia Tech. And guy is just only going to get better. And will really help the Stevens align with the loss of Jeremiah Tauchu.
Freeman from Hogansville, Georgia, went to Callaway. Smart kid, too. He's a chemistry major early on here in his Georgia Tech career. They're going for that fade again, and that time on Walla should have intercepted it. A bad pass, and it slipped right through on Walla's hands.
A little underthrown there. You've got a lot of room over there. Darren Waller did a good job of giving Ty Griffin a lot of room over towards the sideline. You'd like to see that on the back shoulder or somewhere towards that back pylon. So Waller's the only one that's going to have a chance to make a play. as the goal team lines up to go for it on fourth down.
Indeed, fourth and goal from just outside the six. Griffin's going to throw it again, incomplete. I don't know if it was intended for Andrews or Smith, but it went right in between them.
Looked to me like if you'd hit Dennis Andrews early, he might have had a chance to catch it just before the end zone and get in. Kind of went in between both of them. See, Dennis Andrews had a shot at it if it was a little bit more in front of him, and maybe had a shot at scoring as well, but nonetheless, that penalty is on when you have second and goal on the 3-yard line and 2-yard line on that one, the penalty throws you back and it just derails an offensive drive.
Still no touchdowns in the offensive variety for the goal team as White takes back over deep in their own territory at the six. Well, Brady Swilling, he's a man we haven't called the name of. He's going to be the quarterback here, redshirt freshman. So we've seen four of the five quarterbacks. We have not seen Justin Thomas due to injury. But Swilling that time handing it off to Donovan Wilson.
Donovan Wilson, the shade of the 45 underneath the
white
jersey, helping you out a little
started
bit.
Started out on gold, switched to white.
And we were warned that this might happen, the blank jerseys, but just for numbers reasons, you have to rotate guys on the different teams. Doesn't really affect anything. You practice with all these guys over the course of the time in the spring, but throws it off a little bit for us.
Swilling past the 25, still on his feet down the left sideline and near midfield. And getting the jersey dirt and some nice notifications and congratulations from his teammates after a nice run.
And what he does well right there is he gets inside the pitch man, breaks a tackle there off of Isaiah Johnson. And good job by Brady Swilling, doing it against the first defense too. Great job by him.
Mentioned he's a redshirt freshman and a walk-on. Getting a chance late here in the spring game to try to impress. Tucks it, runs. It was hit hard twice and then fell forward and was able to hold on to the football.
He came off that the read with the B-back and had no intentions of pitching it. Just tucks the ball away immediately and gets upfield. He collides with Isaiah Johnson again. Brady Swilling lowering the hammer, lowering the shoulder. Great job by him, man. A little bit of toughness there running up the middle.
And then Minicall finished it up with a tackle from behind. After the gain, second and four.
Donovan Wilson.
Back it goes to Donovan Wilson.
Brought down by number 39,
who redshirted this last year. Wilson, his dad Kenny, very good basketball player, actually played in the NBA for the Denver Nuggets. And Wilson sticking with the sport of football and getting some mud at the top of his helmet there as a little souvenir here in the spring game. St. John Days trying to get to the outside. Got a decent block from Zenon. Well, I got to tell you, partner, we've actually played more than I thought we would play. We were warned that Paul Johnson might call this thing early in the third quarter, but we might get in a full four.
That's what it's looking like so far, and I think the fact that the second half has been a lot better football-wise, fundamentals-wise, than the first has kind of led to the decision of Coach Johnson to let this thing continue. Haven't seen the ball on the ground. It's been actually a joy to watch this fourth quarter.
Pressure coming. Swilling escaped the first would-be tackler. But eventually brought down to the ground.
Swilling was going to have a lot of time to throw. You see Donovan Wilson coming out. Misses the block there on Tyler Stargell, number 99. Had he gotten that block, Brady Swilling's able to get around the defensive end. He'll have a lot of time to throw the ball. He's going to have time to survey the field. It just changed the entire dynamic of that play. It's a huge block for that fullback to get that.
Oh, and there's a fumble. Just as you said, we've seen clean football in this second half. Picking it up and scampering the other way is DeMond Smith, and he's going to get all the way into the end zone. So the gold team has two touchdowns, both by the defense and both by members of the secondary. Isaiah Johnson earlier, And now the redshirt junior, Damon Smith.
And that one, in fact, it squirted out like a bar of soap or something like that. It popped up out immediately. Like a miss. It had to be missed on the quarterback center exchange. But Damon Smith missed his first chance at it. I mean, if he'd have caught it the first time, he would have been contested.
He could have walked it.
Exactly. But decided to, or was able to recover it on the bounce and still took it for the score. So stayed after it.
Damon Smith, who took over at safety last year when Golden went down with the injury. And getting the touchdown there in the spring game to make it 20-12 for the time being. Damon Smith started his career at quarterback, and you see that so often in college, that guys, very good high school quarterbacks, usually the best athlete on their team, and then they come to college, and if they want to see the field, they just have to adjust somewhere else.
And particularly in this offense, Coach Johnson loves to recruit talented athletic quarterbacks. See the ball on the ground one more time. A little bit of a collision in the backfield between Ty Griffin and his be back there, Matt Connors.
Well, you mentioned all the clean play, and then all of a sudden fumbles abound. And this one here from Swilling, picked up by Damon Smith. And he takes it back for the touchdown, escaping the tackle of McNierney and making it a one-score game at Bobby Dodd midway through the fourth. Brady Swilling is going to get another chance to come out here with a white team after that last fumble. Roddy Jones to my right. I'm Brandon Gauden. And a pitch for St. John Days to the 35 he spins to. Seen a lot of St. John Days, B.J. Bostic, and Tony Zinnan. On the other side, Dennis Andrews has been out there, but he has not gotten a carry. I'm a little surprised by that.
And Dennis Andrews, maybe the most explosive of all the A-backs coming back this year, a guy who coach is really looking for to be that big play spark like Robbie Godhigh was and Orwin Smith before him. A little surprised as well, not having seen him get a carry, but he'll certainly be a big part of the Georgia Tech offense this year.
Big number 99, Tyler Stargell, again helping there with a tackle, as was Nick Minicall.
Three-yard gain on the play. Brings up third down and one. Ball on the 39-yard line.
So third and one here for the white crew. One of the backup B-backs has been out there this series in the last. Ryan Broswell wearing number 39 in white. 5'11 redshirt freshman. It's Swilling fighting for the marker.
Swilling on the carry.
And he's close to it. We'll see if they give him the first down. And they will.
We see the quarterback follow again being effective on fourth and short. And the reason it's so effective is because almost like a like an ISO play on a, in a traditional offense, you've got a lead blocker leading up on the linebacker, but you're not taking the ball off the line of scrimmage. So you're not taking it off the line and hand it off to a running back. You've got a quarterback that can find seams. All he has to really do is get in there and dive forward.
By the way, they have been running the clock here in the second half, even on incomplete passes and plays that would normally stop the clock. So we're assuming that's going to happen the rest of the way for the final three and change.
Brought down by number 27, Lynn Griffin.
Seen Isaiah Thomas all over the field today. And, excuse me, Isaiah Johnson.
I was going to say Isaiah Thomas. No, did you watch the Bad Boys 30 for 30 last night?
I did not. I missed it. But I heard a lot about it. But Isaiah Johnson, you talk about the fact that he didn't feel comfortable over the course of last year. That knee just wasn't quite right. Great to see him back out getting comfortable, see him flying around, because he's really going to be an emotional leader for this team. He's a guy that everyone looks up to, and he's great. Just a real good positive influence for this defense.
And such a big loss, Jamia Thomas is. you know, there was so many things going on this offseason, speaking engagements for Coach Johnson, and in every one of those, he said, Jamia Thomas, pound for pound, is arguably the best player that I've ever coached. And that's saying something. That just shows how much he thought of Jamia Thomas, who will hopefully get a chance at the next level.
And Jamia certainly will. And talking to people around the NFL circles, the one thing they talk about Jamia Thomas is his heart. Same thing with Robbie Godhigh, things that you can't measure. Certainly a great athlete, very tough player, strong player, but just played the game hard and always gave his all out there on the field.
Another carry there for Donovan Wilson, who's wearing the white jersey with the number 45 and gold underneath it. There were about 10 players that Paul Johnson had designated as possibly being able to play for both teams, and Wilson, one of those. He played the first half for the gold and the second here for the white team. And he's back in the B-back slot here. And another nice carry before the aforementioned Wilson inside the 35 as we tick inside of 90 seconds.
Tackle made by number 18, Zach Allen.
We didn't get a shot of the white sideline, but watch this. Donovan Wilson laying the boom as he broke into the secondary. Got the white sideline a little excited. No matter who's in the game, you love to see that.
Let's see if the white has one last gasp here to put the icing on the cake in the final minute.
Donovan Wilson on the carry.
That time Wilson not going nearly as far. Probably get one, maybe two plays left out of this one.
As the clock winds down, these players are going to be urging coaching staff to throw it up. Clock's running out.
You think we'll see it here? You think we'll see it?
I don't know. They might go one more play and, you know, call a timeout or something. We're down to 30 seconds.
Let Brady Swilling air this out.
Let him let it go.
Tight formation. And it's just going to be a handoff up the middle instead. And I think that's going to do it. Paul Johnson has just blown the whistle. He's calling the troops to midfield. And the spring game will conclude. We did get a full four quarters in, even with a running clock, albeit in the second half. But the white wins this one 20-12 amidst raindrops abound here in Midtown Atlanta on Good Friday. Well, Roddy, I would say as the game got on, things got a lot cleaner. As early on, Quayshawn Neely got a tackle. Harrison Butker showing the leg. But there were a lot of fumbles early. Offense not as clean, but as things got going later, some good runs like this one from Lasky.
Things did get crisper, as you expected them to in the second half. We saw some rhythm out of both offenses, the white and the gold. As you see early in the game, the turnovers led to two gold defensive touchdowns, which were the two touchdowns that they scored. But we saw a lot of good things. We saw Tim Byerly over the course of the game show some good things, his running ability. Ty Griffin had some great runs. I think there's a lot to take out of the spring game and a lot to be proud of for this Georgia Tech team.
And that'll do it for us. For Roddy Jones and Sean Bedford, I'm Brandon Gauden. The white 20, the gold 12, and 15 spring practices in the books for Paul Johnson and company. For our entire crew, thanks for watching to the Georgia Tech spring football game on ESPN3.